Blade and Stars. This comfortable inn was named for its original sign, an enchanted wooden shield. Painted black, the circular shield displayed an image of a curved silver saber gripped by a pale, slender arm. An enchantment on the shield caused glimmering star-like motes of light to sparkle along the saber's blade. The former innkeeper of the Blade and Stars, a chaotic neutral half-orc bandit named Arjan, used to insist that the illusory effect was the shield's only magic and that it did exactly what she intended it to do, draw in business. Still, it appears that there is more to the shield's story, for recently both Arjan and the shield disappeared. Since then, Arjan's worried wife Lupin, a chaotic good female human commoner, has been running the inn, and loudly expressing her belief that the disappearance is the result of foul play. What kind of foul play, she has no idea. While Arjan was quiet about her past, she had no enemies that Lupin knew about. Lupin furiously rejects the Flaming Fist's conclusion that her wife simply abandoned her. A local vagrant claims to have seen Arjan climb up and remove the sign shield late on the night she went missing, then vanish into an alley with a cloaked figure. Since then though, Lupin has received parcels containing pieces of the shattered shield, each bearing a tiny constellation upon it. Lupin is convinced it's a map, but to where and whether that destination is terrestrial or the heavens, she doesn't know. She is willing to pay to find out though. That little story right there was from the tabletop RPG adventure Baldur's Gate Descent into Avernus. Around 100 years will have passed between Baldur's Gate 2 and 3, and there are a lot of things that we don't yet know about BG3. We do know, however, that the game will take place right after Descent into Avernus. And as I am dungeon mastering my way through this adventure, I am finding a lot of information about the city of Baldur's Gate. In this video, I will talk about the politics and the internal tensions of the city, interesting characters like Grand Duke Alder Ravenguard and the leader of the Thieves Guild, and also stories like the one you heard about Lupin and Arjan. You see, the story that I read, it ends like that. I have the book in physical form and in PDF. I've searched for their names and they are never mentioned again. It says that Lupin would pay good money for help finding her wife, and then nothing more. Why? Well, obviously it's a nice little setup for me, the DM. If I want to add some extra stuff for my players to do, I could write the rest of that quest myself and have my players go to that tavern and talk to Lupin. But what if that isn't all? What if this is a setup for a side quest in Baldur's Gate 3? What if we can use the pieces in the game of that shield to figure out where Arjan is and then reunite her with her wife? I believe that is very possible and there is more of this stuff in here. With early access being released in just over a month from now, let's take a look at some of the awesome things we can find in this adventure. Before we jump in, I should say that this video does contain some big spoilers for Baldur's Gate Descent into Avernus. So if you haven't played that yet and don't want to know anything about it, get out of here now. Go. The rest of you. My name is John Felix and welcome to another video on Baldur's Gate. Now, there is of course one big asterisk to all of this. This douchebag. If this attack happens early in the game, chances are we find a city that's been trashed and a lot of the people we can read about here could be dead or on the run. But this might happen later, or the attack could be more like the attack on Yarthar, which we see in the first gameplay reveal trailer, and most of the city is still intact. If so, the city we find in Baldur's Gate Descent into Avernus should pretty much be the city we find in Baldur's Gate 3. So how is that city? Baldur's Gate is ruled by the Council of Four. These four are the four dukes, out of which one is the Grand Duke, who effectively is the leader of the city-state. There's always a big tension in the city thanks to its very deliberate segregation. There is the upper city, the lower city, and now also the outer city. This segregation is a subject for another video I have in mind and might do, but there is an other political tension in Descent into Avernus. One of the dukes, Thalamra Van Thampur, wants to become Grand Duke. To achieve this, she has, together with Thavius Krieg, High Overseer of Elturel, and that nasty prick responsible for the city's fall, lured Grand Duke Alder Ravenguard to Elturel, which means, in this adventure, he is trapped in the city as it disappears into the first layer of the Nine Hells, as it descends into Avernus. There are, however, heroes in this adventure who manage to get Alder Ravenguard back to Baldur's Gate, and in the process of doing so, takes down the Van Thampur family, which brings brings us to the central tension I believe we will find in Baldur's Gate 3. There are only three dukes, and a replacement to Thalamra must be selected. Which means that there's potential for an interesting political power struggle, which in a city such as Baldur's Gate will mean a lot of foul play and spilled blood. Alder Ravengard, Grand Duke. Alder Ravengard used his military position as Supreme Marshal of the Flaming Fist to get a seat on the Council of Four. After the death of two of his fellow dukes, Ravengard got support from large parts of the commoners and those in Parliament who had grown tired of the political establishment, and assumed the position of Grand Duke. A move that made him leader of both the government and the city-state's military, and thereby the most powerful man in Baldur's Gate. With such power comes a lot of enemies. More often than not, he finds his hands tied by bureaucracy and political opposition. Grand Duke Ravengard is one of the few powerful people who would put the interests of the city before his own and those of powerful patriarch families. And Baldur's Gate is a dangerous city to have enemies in, something he knows all too well after his time in Avernus. Liara Porter, Flaming Fist Commander. Liara Porter is niece to Duke Dillard Porter and one of the higher-ups in the Flaming Fist. When descent into Avernus begins, the Flaming Fist is in a heap of trouble. The fall of Elturel has resulted in waves of refugees, the leader, Old the Ravengard, is gone, and the Cult of the Dead Three are murdering and kidnapping citizens during the night. To sort this out, Duke Porter has summoned his niece Liara, who's in charge of the Flaming Fist outpost Fort Belurian on the peninsula of Chult. Liara arrives in Baldur's Gate at the end of Chapter 1 of Descent into Avernus and takes control of the Flaming Fist. She aims to become Alder Ravengard's successor, but holds him in high regard and hopes he'll return safely. By the end of the adventure, Alder Ravengard does return to Baldur's Gate, but chances are Liara is still in the city during Baldur's Gate 3. Ninefinger Keen, leader of the Thieves Guild. Ninefinger Keen is the leader of the city's Thieves Guild. One of the greatest strengths lies in her forgettable looks. Keen looks like an average middle-aged citizen and has no interest in displaying her wealth and power through her appearance. She is as respected as she is feared, but at the same time a pragmatist and will only enact vengeance and violence when it is profitable for the guild to do so. Silvera Savica. If knowledge is power, few are as powerful as Silvera Savica. Silvera is a tiefling archmage and one of the most respected sages at Candlekeep. She resides in her laboratory in one of the Candlekeep spires with her quasi-familiar Jezebel. Silvera specializes in knowledge surrounding the outer planes and is somewhat of an expert on infernal puzzle boxes. Considering the predicament we'll find ourselves in Baldur's Gate 3, I find it highly unlikely if we never go to Candlekeep for guidance. This final part is my favorite part of the video. I read these little stories and imagine how much fun they could be to play. At the same time, it is pure speculation that they will be in Baldur's Gate 3 at all. That isn't confirmed by any means. However, there are a few more unsolved stories that can be found in Descent into Avernus on top of the one that I've read at the start of the video. One of which is Bormul House. Situated in the Manorborn neighborhood, Bormul House is an elegant three-story townhouse of yellow granite and slate with cream-colored roses climbing its garden walls. Last spring, a distant uncle came for a holiday visit, bringing a large load of baggage. The house servants acted strangely during his visit, though the Bormuls attributed this to a bout of shellfish poisoning that afflicted many households that spring. Days later, the uncle departed, leaving some of his curios behind. The Bormuls, lacking space to store these unwanted things in the manor, moved them to the family crypt beneath the house. There they lie now, largely forgotten. Not long after, shantytown residents in the outer city began suffering brutal attacks by a silent murderer wearing an archaic, threadbare patriarch's cloak. Many have glimpsed this pale killer, but no one has ever been able to confront or follow the murderer to his lair, for he seems to melt into the city's fog after each slaying. Mandorca's Mansion. The only blight in otherwise upscale Bloomridge, this mansion appeared out of nowhere in the middle of the night, taking over a previously vacant lot. Fully staffed with close-lipped servants, the imposing manse hosted a few lavish parties for the lower city elite, presided over by an eccentric and brooding human wizard named Mandorca. And then, just as suddenly as he had appeared, Mandorca shut the manor's doors and vanished from public life. Curious locals who peered through the windows reported a completely empty manor, its furniture looking as though it hadn't been touched in years. Yet soon thereafter, individuals around the city began to receive invitations to visit, written in silver on black paper folded into pentagons. Those who entered the mansion for the requested appointments, they never emerged. After a handful of such disappearances, a Flaming Fist squad smashed its way into the building. Only two of its members emerged, babbling about shifting rooms and blood-soaked abattoirs filled with writhing hooks and chains. With no laborers willing to tear the place down, the Council of Four boarded up the doors and left the mansion standing. For decades now, no one has been observed going in or out. Whether the little black invitations that still occasionally appear on citizens' doorsteps are genuine or harmless pranks remain anyone's guess. In truth, Mandorca gained occult knowledge and his magical manner in a bargain with the obese twin chain devils Kyrix and Valisog. For years, Mandorca upheld his side of the contract by bringing the fiends mortal sacrifices until an accidental breach of contract let the devils haul him screaming into the Nine Hells. Since then, the mansion's hungry traps and shape-changing powers have lain dormant. Recently, however, a group of cultists have broken into the house, seeking to harness its fell powers. Though they haven't yet figured out how to commune with the Chain Devils, when they do, it'll likely be without the safeguards that Mandorca managed to negotiate, potentially resulting in a fiendish disaster for the whole neighborhood. Candulhallow's funeral arrangements. For as long as anyone can remember, the Moon Elves of the Candulhallow family have managed the city's small fleet of corpse carts. Though the family members rarely push the carts themselves anymore, their terse agents are a constant sight around the city, picking up the dead and using hand-drawn wagons to haul their shrouded loads to the Shrine of the Suffering, or outlying cemeteries funded by city stipends and tips from grieving loved ones. In secret, the Candulhallows have grown quietly rich of a variety of death-related scams. Chief among these is a secret smuggling arrangement with Nine Fingers Keen to conceal contraband in corpses' funeral wrappings, which the guards and toll collectors never check. Even less savory is the harvesting and sale of corpses or their parts for the city's cultists and necromancers. Chief among these latter customers is the family matriarch Leylena Candulhallow. A neutral, evil female moon elf who takes the choicest and rarest of the deceased for her experiments, replacing them with paupers' corpses and weighted coffins. Should any of the family's misdealings come to light, it would doubtlessly shock the city to the core and potentially force Leylena to reveal the elaborate necromantic masterpiece, an evolution of both art and life that she's been slowly patching together for months in her basement. Thank you so much for watching this video. It was a fun one to make, and I hope you liked it. If you did, do subscribe to the channel for more content on Baldur's Gate 3. I'd also love to hear what you think about these characters and these stories that we can find in Descent into Avernus, and probably also in Baldur's Gate 3. You can tell me down in the comments section, or in my Discord server, or you can come to my Twitch channel, where not too long from now I'll be playing the early access version of Baldur's Gate 3. Links to all those things can be found in the description below. Once again, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.